Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio is social justice. As ever, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers in order to allow as many members to ask the questions as possible. And at question number one, I call Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Housing Minister has had with ministerial colleagues regarding support available for veterans at risk of homelessness.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The Veterans Minister attends a ministerial oversight group on homelessness, which I chair, in order to make connections across portfolios. This group last met on the 5th of June 2024 and has met four times previously. Working alongside the Veterans Minister, I am committed to raising the profile of veterans' housing and homelessness at relevant meetings to ensure stakeholders are aware of their obligations to provide veterans in Scotland with the best possible advice and support. I have subsequently had similar discussions with the Scottish Veterans Commissioner and veterans' housing organisations.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Veterans often struggle to navigate the myriad of support available to them, whether it be for homelessness, addiction or access to employment. Would the Scottish Government consider coordinating and documenting all support available in order to create a one-stop shop for veteran support?
Minister.
Yeah, I'm happy to have that discussion with Maurice Golden on that, and I think discussions we've had previously talked about housing options in Edinburgh who do that job here in Edinburgh, but happy to pick up another part of Scotland and see what we can do around about that issue. But happy to pick that up with Mr Golden.
Supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following Poppy Scotland's successful Count Them In campaign, census information on the number of veterans in Scotland has recently been published for the first time. So can I ask the Minister how the Scottish Government plans to use this information to better support veterans, including through preventing homelessness?
Minister.
The inclusion of a question on veteran status in the census for the first time marked a significant step forward in developing the evidence base on veterans in Scotland and their characteristics. In conjunction with our annual National Homelessness Statistics, officials will analyse the census outputs, which we will use to consider how we continue to support veterans and their families. A further output update on our work to use emerging evidence to understand more about the circumstances and needs of veterans will be provided in the Veterans Minister's next annual update to Parliament.
Thank you. Question number two, James Dornan. Mr Dornan is joining us online. Mr Dornan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact the second round of the Child Poverty Practice Accelerator Fund is anticipated to have in advancing the First Minister's mission to eradicate child poverty in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
I was delighted last week to announce round two of the Child Poverty Practice Accelerator Fund, which supports the First Minister's mission to eradicate child poverty. We will make up to £500,000 available this financial year to support projects to test new and innovative ways to support this mission. This builds on the fund's first round, launched in 2023, which is supporting a range of work, including important early intervention. Local authorities and health boards are already undertaking transformative work to tackle child poverty, and this fund supports them to go further to address the root causes.
James Dornan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Child Poverty Practice Accelerator Fund demonstrates how real investment towards eradicating child poverty benefits families, our society and our economy. Under the plans put forward by the major Westminster parties, however, it seems that both the Tories and Labour are unwilling to make that investment, instead opting for low taxes for high earners and painful public spending cuts. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what actions she and the Scottish Government require from the incoming UK Government if we are to achieve the First Minister's mission to end child poverty in Scotland for good?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the First Minister has said, and I have also said in this chamber before, we stand ready to work with an incoming UK government to not only tackle but eradicate child poverty. Mr Dornan is quite right to point out to the choices that make that more difficult, and both major Westminster parties, as he says, are focusing on low taxes for high earners and painful public spending rather than the eradication of child poverty. And it is disappointing to see that as the Scottish Government commits over £3 billion this year two policies which tackle poverty, we do not yet see any change being suggested there at Westminster. That will inevitably make the Scottish Government's job more difficult, but we are determined to do what we can within the fixed financial envelope that we have and the powers available to the Parliament.
And supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The scale of the challenge facing us in Scotland is serious. Poverty levels have been static for the 17 years of this SNP government. So attempts to find new and effective approaches are, of course, welcome. I think where stakeholders will be concerned is how frustratingly slow often turnaround is between learning about good practice and actually implementing it across the country. And indeed, the Poverty and Inequality Commission report has said that the government's next update on child poverty figures cannot just point to actions already taken, nor propose more small-scale tests of change. So how will the Cabinet Secretary ensure that learning from this fund is used nationwide to give us whatever chance is left of meeting statutory 2030 targets?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this government remains absolutely committed to achieving the targets that have been laid down in statute on child poverty, Presiding Officer. And I would point, of course, to the Scottish Child Payment as something which is not yet showing up in the modelling within the statistics at the moment, but our modelling does suggest is having a very, very important impact. What will not help, inevitably, Presiding Officer, is the £18 billion worth of cuts to public services, which the Institute for Fiscal Studies is suggesting that both Labour and the Conservative spending plans will have on our public services. And that does make it more difficult, Presiding
Officer. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary, please resume your seat for a second. I won't have the sedentary chit-chat across the benches whilst somebody else is speaking. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, please resume.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. That does make it more difficult for us to eradicate child poverty, but as I said in my original answer, we are determined to do everything that we can. The children and their families within Scotland deserve no less of this government and indeed any incoming UK government.
Thank you. Question number three has been withdrawn. I call question number four, Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that homeless women...
Sorry, Ms. Ring, do we have a microphone?
Apologies, Presiding Officer.
Thank you.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that homeless women are not safe in hostels.
Minister Cook-Abstewart.
It is vital that the use of emergency accommodation for women experiencing homelessness does not exacerbate any of the issues that may have led them to presenting as homeless. For example, domestic abuse, mental health issues, substance use or disability or impairment. Temporary accommodation is an important safety net and care must be taken when providing support services to ensure the safety of everyone is accommodated. And our homelessness statistics show that the social rented sector is the most common type of temporary accommodation used by local authorities at 55%, with hostels only used in a small number of cases at 9%.
Ash Regan.
In the most recent figures up to 2022, 67 women in Scotland have died in homeless accommodation over a three-year period. And the situation is steadily getting worse through systemic failure, and this is acknowledged by the housing regulator. Sinead Watson, a 33-year-old woman, spent 40 weeks in homeless accommodation and spoke of her experience. She said, "Over the past months, I've stayed in three separate hostels. I've been threatened, assaulted, and robbed. I've had no sense of security or safety, and women with addiction are bribed into sex. I saw it in all three hostels that I stayed in. The women in these hostels are fair game." End quotation. We urgently need safe, secure, same-sex emergency housing to stop more women from dying as a simple first step to ensure that these vulnerable women in crisis are not put
Ms.
at
Regan,
further risk of rape, of sexual assault and trauma. So will the government commit to providing vulnerable women in crisis by ensuring that temporary accommodation in Scotland is single-sex?
Minister.
Thank you, and I thank Ash Regan for raising such an important point and pointing out the trauma that women are going through. The Scottish Government is committed to dignity and respect for all. The Equality Act 2010 provides protection for women. The Scottish Government strongly supports the separate and single-sex exceptions that are in the 2010 Act, which can allow for women to have their single-sex spaces. Thank you.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I agree with Ash Reagan, and I think the government need to really understand the facts of what people are experiencing. The Minister mentioned 9%. In Edinburgh, that is much higher. And people are being mixed together in unacceptable situations of families, of single men and of women who are experiencing homelessness but also have often fled domestic abuse situations and are then put into these situations and often leave them to become homeless because they feel more safe on the streets. So can I ask the Minister if she will actually look at reviewing this situation and get the third sector to be part of that, because for so many options out there, we're not using the third sector and they're wanting to be part of a solution.
Minister.
Thank you for raising that. The Scottish Government Delivering Equally Safe Fund is providing over £7 million this year to local women's aids group for support for services for women and children. And we have introduced provisions in the Housing Bill, which, if passed, will put a duty on social landlords to develop and implement a domestic abuse policy outlining how they will support their tenants who are at risk of homelessness, including protecting the right of women to stay safely in their own homes. And we will continue to work closely with the Housing and Violence Against Women and Girls sectors to develop statutory guidance to accompany this duty.
Question number 5, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many homes provided by social landlords have been identified as containing reinforced, autoclaved, aerated concrete.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The Scottish Housing Regulator has been engaging with social landlords to understand the context of RAC in their properties. The latest figures from the regulator show that 13 social landlords have identified the presence of RAC, with 1,994 homes affected.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Minister for that reply? Last week we marked the 7th anniversary of the Grenfell Tower tragedy. It has taken the Scottish Government 7 years to bring forward and get past the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Act. In 7 years, only 2 multi-storey dwellings in Scotland out of more than 100 have had any remedial action taken to remove inflammable cladding. People have been evacuated from their homes from Tillicoultry to Torrey because of the dangers of reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete. How long will they have to wait? What is the government's timescale for ensuring that all those living with RAC in their homes across Scotland are safe?
Minister.
Yeah, I think there's a number of issues. The cladding issue is obviously similar in some ways to RAC, but it's different in many other ways. I think RAC can be present within buildings, but doesn't provide that immediate risk. I've engaged with a number of local authorities, West Lothian and in Aberdeen, for example, in terms of that, to look at the specific options that they're looking at. And so we're awaiting option appraisals from a number of local authorities. So I'm meeting regularly with them in terms of that. As I say, there are specific guidelines that recommend, you know, whether a property is safe or not. Of course, I will continue to engage with local authorities in that regard, and as with the regulator. I'm happy to discuss that further with Mr Leonard.
And supplementary, Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. With the Scottish Budget already stretched to the limit by Westminster capital spending cuts, will the Minister call on the incoming UK Government to prioritise a dedicated RAC fund as a matter of urgency with appropriate consequentials for Scotland?
Minister.
Yeah, as you'll be aware, previously the Chancellor had committed to spend, quote, spend what is necessary to deal with the issue of RAC. However, no funding has been forthcoming and neither the Labour Party nor Conservatives are committed to any financial support in the election manifestos. In addition, the UK Government failed to inflation-proof their capital budget, which has resulted in nearly 9% real terms cut in our UK capital funding between 23-24 and 27-28. And I hope that members across the Chamber will join with me in calling on an incoming UK Government to deliver eradicated funding. I can hear Mr Leonard talking about that. If he can speak to any influence he has with a UK Chancellor or UK Housing Minister, happy to do that and discuss it.
Members, it's not a kind of free-for-all across the Chamber. Through the Chair, please. Thank you. Question number 6, Russell Finlay.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the provision of emergency homeless accommodation in the West Scotland region.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Scotland has the strongest rights across the UK for people experiencing homelessness, and local authorities have a duty to provide temporary accommodation to any homeless household that needs it. In some cases, this may be on an emergency basis. Local authorities are responsible for assessing demand for temporary accommodation and provision in their area. Recent homelessness statistics show local authorities in the West Scotland region are consistently providing temporary accommodation to those who require it. We have maintained the homeless budget at broadly similar levels to last year, and I meet regularly with housing communities across Scotland to understand pressures in the area. Just on Tuesday we met, including the demand for temporary accommodation. I also met Glasgow this morning to discuss that specific issue.
Russell Findlay.
Thank you. 2 weeks ago, I attended a meeting with Police Scotland and others about a hotel in Paisley being used as emergency accommodation. Local families are living in fear due to regular outbreaks of violence and blatant drug dealing. Police are never far away from the place. The authorities wrongly downplay this as antisocial behaviour, which it is not. It is criminality. One woman told the Paisley Daily Express, and I quote, "They're drinking, smoking, smashing glass, swearing, and making abusive comments to people, particularly women and kids, when they go past. It's unpleasant and threatening." So what, if anything, can the Scottish Government do to end this misery for residents?
Minister.
Some context, I think local authorities in the West of Scotland region, Mr Finlay represents, are receiving over £1 million of funding for rapid rehousing transition plans. About the actual specific property he's on about, happy to pick that up. It's not something I've had fed back to myself, but happy to liaise with yourself on that specific issue and take forward with officials.
And supplementary, Bob Doris.
Thank you, President Officer. The erosion of UK government benefits, including housing benefits, is a significant driver of homelessness and the need for emergency accommodation in Glasgow, the west of Scotland and beyond. Has the Scottish Government made any assessment of the record £90 million of discretionary housing payments it has provided to mitigate these cuts? And does the Minister agree that the key way to support homelessness prevention and avoid emergency accommodation in the first place going forward is for any incoming UK Government to significantly uplift housing benefits which have been gutted by a decade of Tory austerity?
Minister.
Yeah, I fully agree with the member's statement, and it's backed up by the recent report by Crisis through the Homelessness Monitor, which actually picked up two of the biggest issues was local housing allowance and the rate of universal credit. So again, that's backed up with them. This year, we've increased the funding for discretionary housing payments by £6.8 million, providing additional support for households struggling to meet housing costs. Discretionary housing payments are a vital tool to reduce poverty, safeguard tenancies and prevent homelessness. However, that we need to spend this money at all shows the UK welfare system is not fit for purpose. We will continue to push whichever party forms next to our government to end the bedroom tax, scrap the benefit cap and permanently link local housing allowance rates with rents to end uncertainty that private renters face.
Question number 7, Pam Gozell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to tackle poverty in black and minority ethnic households.
Minister Kilcap-Stewart.
Despite Scotland receiving the most challenging settlement in devolution in last year's UK government budget, the Scottish Government is doing all it can to prioritise investment to tackle and reduce poverty in Scotland, including investment that will benefit black and minority ethnic households. This includes committing £6.3 million in social security benefits and payments, investing nearly £600 million to support the delivery of affordable homes and providing over £370 million to enable free bus pass travel for over 2 million people. In addition, our anti-racist employment strategy seeks to reduce income inequality for racialised minorities by supporting employers to address barriers so they can enter, progress and stay in employment.
Pam Gozell.
I thank the Minister for that answer. According to the Coalition for Racial Equality and Rights, underemployment disproportionality affects black and minority ethnic communities, with underemployment severely contributing to the growing proportion of families in work poverty. Therefore, I ask the Minister, what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that high quality and secure work is made available for people from the black and minority ethnic backgrounds?
Minister.
Thank you. I thank Pam Gosell for that question. I referred to the anti-racist employment strategy, I do believe that it is having an impact. It sets out the actions that the Scottish Government will take to reduce employment inequalities for racialised minorities. This includes evaluation of the Minority Ethnic Recruitment Toolkit that we published in 2020 and the development of an anti-racist workplace training framework. Impact of these actions will be measured through the Fair Work Evidence Plan to ensure that they are supporting our ambition of becoming a fair work nation.
And question number 8, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of Audit Scotland's analysis showing that Social Security Scotland's benefit expenditure budget was £5.1 billion in 2023-24, which was an increase of 22% on its 2022-23 budget, what action it is taking to reduce expenditure on Social Security benefits, including through assisting people into meaningful paid employment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Social Security is a priority for this Government, and we are proud of the significant investment to ensure people receive the support they are entitled to. When all our benefits have been introduced and clients have been transferred from the DWP, Social Security Scotland will support around 1 in 3 people in Scotland, the vast majority of whom are disabled and unpaid carers. We continue to support employment opportunities within the limits of our devolved powers, with this year up to £90 million for employability services through No One Left Behind and the remaining delivery of Fair Start Scotland.
Jimmy Green.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? And I'm pleased that she mentioned those in our workforce, for example, with disabilities. One of the points of feedback from Inclusion Scotland was that many people who had to leave the workplace due to the pandemic have struggled to get back into work and have found the whole process quite daunting. So I wanted to ask what the Scottish Government is doing to support job seekers, but also employers themselves, to help assist those who have been out of the workplace for particularly a long period of time to make that move, which can be daunting, and get them back into that workforce.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Jamie Green for that question? It is very important that we do look at the disability employment gap and what can be done. Some of the responsibility and powers for that lies with the Scottish Government and some with the UK Government, and it is something both governments need to do more on. We are determined to do just that. There are a number of mechanisms and policies that are in place, and I mentioned No One Left Behind within my original answer, Presiding Officer. That is a very important way that a tailor service can be made available to everybody. And of course, within the work that the Government does is also the work we do with employers to ensure that they recognise the importance and the significance of the role that disabled people and indeed their carers can play in the employment market, even those who have perhaps not been in the labour market for some time. And that's absolutely a commitment we're determined to take forward.
And supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 4th of June, during Stage 1 of the Social Security Amendment Bill, Tory Social Security spokesperson Jeremy Balfour said, and I quote, "As a Parliament, we should be demanding that all benefits in Scotland are inflation-proofed. This should be a priority, even if our block grant from the UK Government is below inflation." Mr Green clearly disagrees. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that it's astonishing that the Tories are utterly incapable of speaking with one voice on something as fundamental as Social Security Scotland's budget?
Cabinet Secretary, for the matters within your responsibility.
Well, Mr Gibson is quite right to point out about the, shall I say, the variety of different calls that I receive from the Scottish Conservatives on this issue. Jamie Green, in his original question, seemed to suggest we may wish to or need to cut the social security expenditure here. I would say to the Conservatives and indeed to the Labour Party, who share the policies on social security with the Conservatives, that the best way that we can perhaps do that is through changes within the UK social security system, so that we did not have to spend, for example, £134 million a year mitigating some of the worst excesses of the UK government system. That would allow the Scottish Government to work to introduce more anti-poverty measures, something this Government is determined to do. It is disappointing that the current Government, and it would suggest any incoming Government, is refusing to take up that challenge.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change positions, should they so wish. Thank you.